The order of service for this morning is the order of morning service, beginning on page 5. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto thee that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who hast given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins, and by thy Holy Spirit increase in us true knowledge of thee and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, to the end that by thy grace you may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and hath given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgiveth us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he giveth the power to become the sons of God, and hath promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. We now continue with the introit as printed on your bulletin insert. We are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth. O Lord, make me know my end, and what is the measure of my days? Behold, you have made my days a few handbreadths. And now, O Lord, for what do I wait? Deliver me from all my transgressions. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear to my cry. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth. Glory be to God on high. Thank you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, so govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that, ever mindful of your glorious return, we may persevere in both faith and holiness of living. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated for the readings. The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 51. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation. For a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice for a light to the peoples. My righteousness draws near, my salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens vanish like smoke, and the earth will wear out like a garment, and they who dwell in it will die in like manner. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. Here endeth the reading. Our epistle is from Jude. But you, beloved, build yourselves up in your most holy faith. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority, before all time, and now, and forever. Amen. Here endeth the reading. Please rise as we read the gradual. These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. Blessed are those whose strength is in you. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 13th chapter. Jesus said, "In those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or when the cock crows, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake. Here endeth the gospel. We now confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed as found on page 12. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge both the quick and dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the hymn of the day. Thank you. Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. Amen. The text this morning is the gospel reading in which Christ gives the command to stay awake. You may be seated. What to do in the face of the end times? It's the last thing Jesus addresses before he begins in the preparation for his burial. All that's left is that he has the woman come and anoint him. And from there, the journey to the Last Supper begins. The journey to his death. And so this is the last thing he addresses. It's the final subject he teaches, just as it itself is about final matters. The disciples only asked when they would be, but Jesus led it into this warning, that since no one knows the day or the hour, stay awake. Disciples didn't quite just ask about the end times, the last days. Kind of just what they did ask, and they did ask, when will these things be? As we heard in our reading from last week, this is a continuation of that sort of discourse. And we still didn't even have the full context in last week's reading, but as they and Jesus were headed out of the temple, the disciples were marveling over all the buildings there, saying, "Look, teacher, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings." They were impressed with the wealth of the earthly Jerusalem. So little did they know the heavenly Jerusalem that awaited them. They were impressed with the gold and the jewels of man stored in these piles of stone, which they heaped up for themselves. Though the heavenly Jerusalem will not be made of stone, but of gold, and the foundation of gemstones. That is how ordinary these things are compared to the treasures of heaven. And so, Jesus told them of these buildings around the temple, that not one stone would be left upon another. They were captivated by this temporary power of the elites of Jerusalem. But they would eventually be overthrown. But for that to happen, Jerusalem would have to be attacked, defeated, conquered. So the disciples wanted to know when this would happen. And so they asked Jesus, "Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign when all these things are about to be accomplished?" Surely, if Jesus knows that it's going to happen, he knows when, right? And so, he gave them an answer. And he told them, firstly, about the destruction of Jerusalem that happened in AD 70, some 40-ish years later. But also, the destruction of the whole world. For yes, those stones in Jerusalem were thrown down, and all that man-made glory they were marveling over was replaced with weeping and gnashing of teeth. But that was just a precursor. The time of Jerusalem, the time of the temple, was over. Christ was the new temple. The church was the new place, was God's new people. They were the new Israel. They were no longer necessary, and the Jews, kept sticking the Romans in the back. And so, yes, every stone was separated from another, but eventually, not only each stone of the earth will be separated, but verily each atom will be unable to sit upon another, for none of them shall exist any longer, at least the ones that exist now. As Christ says, heaven and earth will pass away. At the return of the Son of Man, all the old will pass away to make room for the new, so that God's justice may be fully realized and all will receive their reward. Just as Isaiah foretold that the earth would wear out like a garment and all who dwell in it will die in like manner. But he also says that his salvation will be forever. That salvation is the same as Christ's word. And so, when he returns, he'll gather his elect, his chosen with Christ. They will be gathered, and those who are outside the church will receive the same fate as those who were at the fall of Jerusalem, weeping and gnashing of teeth. But the only precursors to this grand finale that Jesus tells us about are this. But in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Well, it certainly sounds not all that different from what we heard from Daniel last week after a tribulation. And besides that, there's quite obviously wondrous signs. I mean, the sun being darkened, the moon not giving its light. You could say perhaps, maybe what is meant here is if the moon is in a new moon and you have a solar eclipse, that the sun cannot give its light. But it's not as though that's the only way God has prevented the sun's light. For the Egyptians had a full day of 3 days of darkness. The stars will be falling from heaven. Well, perhaps we could say that that might mean a meteor shower. The powers in the heavens will be shaken. Well, we don't really know. Wondrous should be obvious, but really, they're vague enough that I can't really tell. I mean, there have been eclipses, there have been meteor showers, and yet we're still here. Atom still sits upon atom, stone upon stone. This isn't exactly meant, these signs aren't exactly meant to be a timetable. You know, I have an eclipse at 3 o'clock, meteor shower at 4. Yeah, we've got about 30 minutes until the Son of Man comes back. No, not exactly. Instead, to understand the meaning, how we are to interpret this, Christ gives us the example of the fig tree. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. And that's how we would know that the Son of Man is near. Certainly, we can understand that in spring, before summer comes, the leaves begin to sprout. Perhaps you like an illustration here. If we just sit the book here, you'll be able to see that it is tilting and falling, and it is gone. And eventually, there's the thud. You don't see exactly when it's going to happen. You only know that it's near. I mean, it can't be that long until it hits the bottom of the pulpit, right? It's obvious, but the timing isn't obvious. You'd have to know from experience or something. And I don't think any of us have experienced the end of the world quite yet. So this is what we have. We have the signs. In fact, we probably see, you know, people have claimed to see them happening, that the end of the world is near, and they, of course, probably come up with some date. But that's not what we are to do. We only know that it is near at that point, only upon seeing the signs. I have seen an eclipse. I have seen meteor showers. But I have not yet seen the Son of Man return. All I know is that it's near. We only know that God's definition of near is clearly much different than ours. For the disciples were told that the kingdom of God is near, that the return is near. Paul says that the return is soon. They're all waiting. They're expecting it right there in the first century. And yet here we are, 2,000 years later. It's soon. It's near. That's still all the more we know. We know that the signs have come. We know that the tribulation and destruction of Jerusalem has happened. But we have no idea when the Son of Man will return. Hence, he gives us that last command. Stay awake. For as he says, concerning that day or that hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Keep awake. See, the end of the world is a near, present reality for the Christian. But we're given very little we can do about it. But everything else that we're supposed to do. Keep watchful. Keep awake. Act as if his return could be any minute now. Because it may be. We know only to continue in good works, to continue in the faith, to continue in the church, to hear the words of Christ, and to pray. Pray for his soon return. For those words of Christ are the one thing that will not pass away. They are the one thing that will remain. They are the treasure of heaven, over and above gold and jewels, that is to be valued above all else. Because those words confess Christ and his work and what he has done and what he will do yet. They confess that you are forgiven on account of his death, that he has won and redeemed you so that you may have that eternal salvation of God. All the more reason to keep awake for it. All the more reason to keep attention. All the more reason to know when it will come, when the enemy will be destroyed, when we shall finally be saved once for all. When we have not only the command to wait, we need not just the command to wait, but we have the full righteousness of God before us. Those things here are only fleeting. Money changes hands. Power is taken down. The wisdom of men finds only falsehood. And even the most intelligent person on earth cannot find the truth of Christ by himself. What the world values, whether that is truth or wealth or knowledge or power, is nothing in the face of this word of Christ. For when the light of sun is eclipsed by darkness of the moon, the glory of the Son of Man will come and eclipse the glory of men by outshining it so greatly that all we will have is a candle compared to that ball in the sky that provides our light. And he will come so that you, the elect, chosen people of God, may partake in that glory, in that righteousness. That is the reason Christ died. It is why he has won the victory. And the Holy Ghost has bestowed this gift that was won upon you. He continues to keep you in the one true faith. He has taught you that this is true. He has brought truth where we could find none. He has led you to be made new, so that now you shall fit with the new heavens and the new earth. And though, as Isaiah said, all the old will pass away, you shall be new, and you will not pass away, because you reside in that word of Christ, that word that says you are forgiven. He has made you holy, so that you may do good works, so that you may continue the race and find endurance, so that you may not give up, so that you may continue in your faith, and so that finally you may, in the new heavens and new earth, you may be and walk in the presence of God and walk with him face to face, just as you and I would speak and walk. So there is only one final teaching. Since all is one, there's only one thing left. Since you are holy, since you are new, since you are forgiven, all that's left is to stay awake, to keep watch, to see when the Master will return. All has been accomplished for you. All is victorious in Christ. All that is left is not to lose it. Pray for faith. Pray that you may be given endurance. Pray that Christ may come soon. In the name of Jesus, amen. Please rise. May the peace which passes all understanding guard and keep your hearts in Christ Jesus and in the one true faith from now unto life everlasting. Amen. Be seated. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We praise thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thine inestimable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we may show forth thy praise not only with our lips, but in our lives, that, walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days, we may enjoy the testimony of a good conscience and the hope of thy favor, be sustained and comforted under the troubles of this life, and finally be received into thine everlasting kingdom. Through thine infinite mercy in Jesus Christ, our Lord. We offer unto thee our common supplications for the good estate of thy church throughout the world, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit and the bond of peace and in righteousness of life. Send down upon all ministers of the gospel and upon all congregations committed to their charge the healthful spirit of thy grace, and that they may truly please thee, pour upon them the continual dew of thy blessing. Most heartily we beseech thee with thy favor to behold the President and Congress of the United States and all others in authority, and so to replenish them with thy grace, that they may always incline to thy will and walk in thy way. Prosper all good counsels and all just works, that peace and happiness, truth and righteousness, religion and piety may be established among us throughout all generations. We humbly entreat thee also for all sorts and conditions of men, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. May it please thee to preserve all that travel by land or water, to succor that all that are in peril or need, and to satisfy the wants of all thy creatures. We also commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any way afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate, that it may please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. Most especially, we pray on behalf of Ed McCullough, Harold Merkel, Eugene Rehm, Esther Schweier, Jim McCullough, Joyce Lechner, Aubrey Art, Sean Mendez, Austin Art, Thomas Etzler, the Reverend David and Barbara Bush, Barbara Wolford, Charlotte Davis, Maya Kalla, Wanda Schweier, Kenny Miller, Patricia Lee, and the family and friends of Jean Thatcher. Lord of the Church, as this congregation is in a time of pastoral vacancy, grant by your grace that Zion continually be fed by your word, which sustains them unto salvation. Hear us, most merciful God, and these are humble requests, which we offer up unto thee in the name of Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. We pray as our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Grant, we beseech thee, Almighty God, unto thy church, thy Holy Spirit, and the wisdom which cometh down from above, that thy word, as becometh it, may not be bound, but have free course and be preached to the joy and edifying of Christ's holy people, that in steadfast faith we may serve thee, and in the confession of thy name abide unto the end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. You may be seated. We have a couple of announcements. Firstly, that this morning, Jean Thatcher died, and that's why we pray for his family and friends. As it's this morning, we don't have any word on a funeral or visitation yet. Next, we have that Reverend Orr has declined our call, and in light of this, the elders have asked Reverend Hansen if he would be our vacancy pastor, but we still await a response from him on that. Well, thank you for being here this morning as we wrap up the church year. Next Sunday, we begin into Advent and start anticipating the coming of our Lord. Have a blessed week, and I'll see you in the back.